and ever for all you've done for me. Now blessings and glory belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. And I just want to thank you now forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. For me.
always providing for me. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your grace. Great is your mercy towards me. Your loving kindness towards me. Your tender
the love that he shows towards us day after day, then we'll give with a cheerful heart. when Paul was addressing the Corinthians in his letter to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning of verse 6, he said, remember this. I'm reading the easy to read version. He said, remember this. The one who plants few seeds will have a small harvest. But the one who plants a lot will have a big harvest.
Amen.
Each one of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give. You should not give it if it makes you unhappy or if you feel forced to give.
Amen.
God loves those who are happy Amen. To give.
Yeah.
And you know what else he said? He said, and God can give you more blessings than you need.
All right.
And you will always have plenty of everything.
Hallelujah.
You will have enough to give to every good work. As the scriptures say, he gives generously to the poor. His goodness will continue forever. You know, when we think about the scriptures, quite often we don't apply these to our lives. But this is the living word.
Yes.
This is not just a book, a secular book. This is called a living word.
Yes, yes.
And John, he says, this is the Logos.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And when we say the Logos, we mean the word of God. God himself. He said the word was God and the word is God. Hallelujah. So when we're coming to give, we may give in this building and we may have the members collecting the offering, but this is actually a gift to God. We're giving to the work of God. Amen? And we don't want you to be
until the breakthrough comes. So let's take a moment to continue to pray for our nation as we celebrated the day of prayer, National Day of Prayer. We want to continue to add our faith to those things that are going on through our city, through our nation, and globally. Father, we thank you tonight for the chance to come and to pray as a body, as a collected group. And Father, we thank you for the undeniable confidence that we have that you hear us when we pray. For we're not strangers to you, but we love the fact that you have made us your children, that we've been adopted. We've been called the sons and daughters of God by the work of Jesus Christ. And so we come as children to a good Father, making our requests, petitions known unto you, our supplications, our inquiries, for there are things we don't even know how to pray, but we come before you asking you, oh God, to intervene. We ask you to intervene for the economy. We've never seen gas so high. Father, we've never seen these prices where even independent truckers sometimes say they have to spend $1,200 just to fill up their tanks. Father God, we ask you to move on their behalf, on our behalf, oh God. Father God, we thank you for giving us resources that we can put gas in our car to come out tonight. But Lord God, we pray, oh God, for those that are in need and that you would move supernaturally. Father God, we know there's wisdom things we can do, inflate the tires, make sure our car is tuned properly, make sure we plan our trips. But Lord God, we need you to intervene in our economy. Father God, turn this cost thing around in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, there are single mothers and single fathers, there are widows, oh God, those that are going to work that are deeply impacted. Father God, where they have to choose necessities or putting gas in their car, medication or putting gas in their car, food or putting gas in their car. Father, we ask that you would have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy, God. Have mercy. Have mercy, God. Father God, we thank you for intervening on our behalf. Father, we pray, oh God, for those that are in the midst, oh God, of distress. And we speak, oh God, peace. Those who are in the midst of calamity because of the circumstance, how food has gone up in price. Father God, how bills are gone up, that everything has increased. And Father God, we have this strange event that there are jobs all over and wages, but yet we don't see profit. We don't see where it's profiting. The highest hourly wage that I've ever seen in my life. And yet we don't see kandarabasi. The advantage, it lets us know that something's wrong in our land. It lets us know that something's wrong in the spirit of the land, in the hearts of the people. Oh God, we turn to 2 Chronicles that you told Solomon that if ever you're in trouble in leading the country and it seems like there's no rain, and that's what it seems like, God. There's no rain, there's no flourishing, there's drought in places, and there's tragic drought, there's fires, it seems like there's no rain, there's no flourishing. He told Solomon that if this ever occurs, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. You said you would heal the land. Father God, you were speaking to Solomon about Israel. But Lord God, we ask it for America. Oh Father, we will continue to remind you of your word until we see the change in the land. Oh Father, we continue to pray for this war. You told us in Matthew 24 there'll be wars and rumors of wars. Lord God, we've almost gotten complacent about them. Conflicts happen all the time. We just disregard them. But Lord God, we pray for these events are taking a biblical shaping that moves us. So we pray for Russia. We pray for the people of Russia. We pray for Putin. We pray that you would touch his heart. You said that the heart of the king is in your hands. Oh God, touch his heart. That you would turn him from this destructive act. Let him come to a place of repentance and resolve that this enough is enough. That whatever he was trying to execute has reached its course. Lord God, we pray for the people of the Ukraine who now are another dispersion of people all over the world from the Ukraine. I don't think there's any nation that has not received refugees. Oh God, I can only imagine how we would feel if we were uprooted from our houses, our home, our country, because of this calamity. We wouldn't even know how to feel. So we pray for these people. We don't just glancingly call out, but we ask you to have mercy on them, cover them, keep them, protect them emotionally. Let there be a revival. When they can't turn to their armies, they can't turn to their government, they can't even turn to the nations of the world, they can turn towards you. Father God, we pray that there will be a revival, a cry out to you, God, and that you would move through the nation of Ukraine, saving, healing, delivering, touching even the Russian army. Save, heal, deliver them. Oh God, cause them to abandon, oh God, this work of destruction and turn toward a righteous God who will judge iniquity. Oh God, we love you tonight. Thank you for blessing our time, blessing our families, blessing our children, blessing our homes, blessing our bodies. Thank you for refreshing us where we're tired. And causing, oh God, your word, your will, your spirit to abide with us. And we thank you for our service tonight. And we give you praise in advance in Jesus' name. And let everybody say amen and amen. Hallelujah. We thank God and we praise God for our time. Well, I want to continue in the word tonight, and we want you to return to Job, the 22nd chapter, as we've been ministering on the kingdom of God. Say the kingdom of God. And you got to say it with conviction, because we are dual citizens. And when we come to the realization that the citizenship of God is more beneficial than the citizenship of America, then we'll see kingdom of God type results. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm believing that even as we continue this series, that your borders are going to be increased, that your faith will be increased, that your tenacity for the Lord and the Lord's things shall be increased, and that you'll see the results of God in your life. As we started, we began sharing out of the importance of Matthew 6 and 33, where it says, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And these are the words of Jesus. And just as a sidebar, we'll be starting the sayings of Jesus this Monday on Zoom, 7 o'clock p.m. We invite you to be a part of the sayings of Jesus' teaching, where we will review the scriptures and discover what Jesus said, focusing in on what Jesus has been saying. Amen. We are here because we realize that there are undeniable truths about the kingdom that we need to be aware of, and we need to learn how to apply the truths, principles, and teaching of the kingdom in order to benefit. Or we know how to move in a democracy because we vote or we don't vote. Amen. Y'all ain't saying nothing. We know the principles of this democratic republic that we've learned. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I say. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. Yeah. South of Cali Elementary School, kindergarten. We've learned principles of our democracy, and even though we know some of it, we don't know all of the elements of the Constitution of the United States. I want to encourage you to go back and read some of the rights and privileges that we have. We do know that our nation's in an uproar because of the possible reversing of Roe versus Wade. We need to understand these things that are going on and how they compare, align, or disalign with the things of God. But we need to understand not just what goes on with our nation, but the kingdom of God, and how to operate, execute, and manifest kingdom principles for kingdom outcomes. I tell with, share with people all the time that we understand kingdom in a glimpse by understanding some things, by watching England, which has one of the most active monarchs in public view in this contemporary season. And as you know, it's oversaw by a queen, and she has a prince, her son, waiting in the corridors for his time to reign. But how many people know God has already appointed you and I to reign with Christ Jesus, making us kings and priests from the order of Melchizedek, this ruling priest that Abram encountered? He was a ruler of the city of Salem, and he was the priest. He was not of the lineage or the line of priests like Levi, but he was of a royal priesthood. And we have been grafted into this royal priesthood like Christ. And this is important because we need to understand the principles of kingdom rule. And declaring and decreeing is one of those principles. Here in Job, the 22nd chapter, it says this, as Job is lamenting over his circumstance and having a dialogue with God, and God is speaking back to Job about his condition. As you know, Job was a man that was wealthy. He had everything rolling with him, and then the devil wanted to try him, and so as a result, God gave permission. Job lost everything, and he was perplexed because he wanted to know where I stood with God. And he's in a dialogue here. You can start at 22 and read some of the exchanges as God shares with Job some things, and Job talks with God. But I love this place that we arrive to that pertains to our subject tonight. and its continuation. It's that of the principle of declare, decree, and establish. Say declare, decree, and establish. That's the third hook that we want to give you to start opening up with you. It says this in Job 22, and I'll start at 27. Thou shalt make thy prayer unto him, and he shall hear thee, and thou shalt pray thy vow, pay thy vows. Say, pray your prayer, pay your vows. Verse 28, thou shalt also, say also, decree a thing, and it shall be established unto thee. When we think about this idea of decree, it's important to understand that this is a royal term. And oftentimes, people who are not associated with royalty do not understand. It is a means by which the words of a leader, a royal figure, execute change in the earth realm, his community or his kingdom. I love the King James Bible. I know that there are many verses and they're yet making new versions of the Bible. There's the King James, the New King James, the NIV, the Recovery Bible, the New Life Bible, the Application Bible, the Negro Bible. There's more versions then we know what to do with. And they all offer some wonderful nuances of information. But I love the King James because it's kingdom language. It was royal language. And I know there's some who have critical position about King James and his editing on some of the Bible, but it's kingdom language. The thuses and the those and the these put me in a mindset of regalness, of godliness, of divineness. And that's what I want us to capture tonight. And the idea of decreeing a thing is a royal term. It's a term that offers insight into who we are as believers. Say, look at your neighbor, say, do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? I love this. I want you to see something in action. You can put your envelope there. Turn to Matthew, the 8th chapter. We find the application of decree in action in Matthew 8. When we read the Hebrew definition of decree, it is unique in its verbiage, because it is a word, gazar. Say gazar. Yes. It doesn't mean to speak, which you would cognitively think it means to speak, and it does. But the word gazar means to cut, to divide, to cut down, to cut into pieces, to cut it in two. It means to snatch. And so when we decree a thing, we need to get a mindset. We're just not talking, but we're cutting some things down. What are you cutting down? The things that the devil has put in our life to keep us from the things of God. We're cutting and dividing them in two, and we're bringing them to naught. So your words are forces that bring change. The word decree means to cut up, divide, to cut into pieces. So when we use this forceful agent, oftentimes as a conduit in prayer, and I want to just say that it's used in a prayerful turn, but it's more than just a prayer. It is a reinstitution of what said condition is. Are you in Matthew 8? We find Jesus, who is the Son of God, is a master of the declaration. You see, the kingdom of God is voice activated. Say voice activated. In the book of Genesis, that's why I want to keep all this array here. We're in the garden. Go back to the garden. God created Adam and Eve. Come on up here, Adam and Eve. No, I'm just kidding, y'all. Y'all did a beautiful job.
Amen.
But one of the things that he gave to Adam and Eve to do was to speak. And some theologians say this is the primary difference that Adam had above all the creation. He was able to speak and name all the creatures. And the Bible said that is what they were. You see, when Adam called them something, that's what it was.
Right.
Say, death and life is in my tongue. The Bible says that he called a dog, and it was a dog. He called a rabbit, and that's what it did. It rabbited, it jumped, amen. Call a lion, and it roared, amen. He spoke or decreed something, and it became what he said. It wasn't so much that it was when it was created, but it manifested when he spoke its name. He called it out. God operates in the declared word, and in creation, we find that scripture says that God spoke in Genesis. He said light, and it was light. He decreed a thing. He spoke it into existence. Say the kingdom is voice activated. That's why your words, 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 your words have power to destroy or to build. Your words, your words. Come on, say with me, my words, my words, my words, my words, my words. Oh yeah, you see, I gotta get us used to saying stuff. One of the things that was evident about a king always had a scribe with him walking around. If you look through history, pharaohs had a scribe, a writer. Medieval kings had a writer, Edwards, and the czars had a scribe to write. Why? Because when they spoke, they were groomed and they were taught from children. When you take the realm of king, when you speak, your words become law. So be careful what you say. Say, be careful what you say. A king could not say anything. He would not say anything. And when we went to Esther last week, we found that because the king was prompted to rebuke his wife, he spoke it. And so he couldn't turn back from what he said. Another illustration of a king's commitment to his words was in Daniel. Don't you remember? King Nebuchadnezzar fell in love with Daniel. Daniel began to interpret all the things that were going on in the king's life. And it came to a situation where his subjects, some of his leaders, tricked him because they knew Daniel wouldn't bow to an image, and they had to throw Daniel in the lion's den. Y'all don't remember y'all Bible, do you? But because he said it, even though he loved Daniel, he couldn't back out of his word, or his integrity as a king would be wanting. See, the problem with us is that we don't mind saying one thing and doing another. We'll tell a lie and justify it. Well, that's, God understands why I had to tell that lie. We even give them a pass. We call them white lies. Y'all ain't saying nothing. A lie is a lie to God. As a matter of fact, he said, a lie shall not tarry in his sight. Say, tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Even if you get your butt beat, y'all ain't saying nothing. Isn't that what your mama told me? Now listen, I don't know what you told the people in school, but you tell me the truth. Because you know mama had your back, but don't you put mama out there with no foolishness. Anybody remember mama telling you that? You got the finger. You tell me the truth. What happened? Norris hit me and I hit him back and knocked the lamp off the stand and it broke. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Must be getting my heart right in Jesus' name. Unconfessed issues. A king would speak and his words would become law. And not just any kind of law, the law of the land. Now just think about your words. The words we say. That's why the Bible says that we're going to give an account for every idle word spoken out of our lips. The Bible says that not only are there warring angels, not only are there messenger bringing angels, Michael, Gabriel, not only are there seraphims, angels to keep the glory of God from consuming us when we worship, y'all ain't saying nothing, but there are angels that write down every word that we say. Isn't that something? Did I tell you about the angel that watches the offering? See what you put in it? Y'all ain't saying nothing. But there are angels that walk right down every word that you say. So when the devil accuses us before the courts of God, we can say, read the record. What did I say? Jesus is my Savior. That's the line we better have written down. That I accept Jesus as Lord of my life. You better have that written down somewhere in an angel record. What did I say? You listening to Bishop? Matthew 8, we find Jesus having a supernatural encounter their eyes. Oh, I ain't getting a whole lot of shouts on that. We must expand our mindset and our dependence on God. And we've oftentimes said, well, I can't heal anybody. We can't. But we come with the wrong approach. Look what Jesus said. Jesus said, I will come and heal him. Jesus said, I wasn't going to come and pray for him. He said, I'm going to heal him. If I get there, things are going to change. I'm going to come and change some things. Verse 8 said, the centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof. And it's true. He was familiar with the culture, because the culture was of such that a rabbi would not come to a Roman pagan's house for nothing. But you know how many people know Jesus wasn't like the world? Even now, rabbinical Jews, Orthodox Jews, may not even come to a Gentile's house or into a Gentile's business or into a Gentile facility, in that it will defile them. But Jesus said, I come and heal. Centurion said, no, don't come. I'm not worthy. And thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word. He didn't say think the word, did he? He didn't say talk a good talk, did he? He just said, just speak the word. What is that? That is declaring a thing. He said, just speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. Then he goes on to describe. He says, for I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled, and said to them that followed, verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith. Say great faith. Great. No, not in Israel. And I say unto you, that's a decree, that many shall come from the east and west and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That was a prophetic utterance in the midst of this dialogue. And Jesus, verse 13, said unto the centurion, as a decree, go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. And his servant was healed in the self same hour. Hallelujah! Jesus didn't pray for his healing, but he decreed his healing under the authority of God. He called it out. He said it was so, and it was so. And we find that this wonderful example to be an illustration, just a sampling of this idea, this thought. And we mess up when we move out of speaking and into actions other than. Children of Israel wandering in the wilderness got thirsty. God told Moses to speak to the rock. But because Moses was angry at the children of Israel's lack of faith, what did he do? He struck the rock. How many of us are striking things when we should be speaking things? Help us, God. We have to speak, declare, and decree. And what will happen? Job says, these things shall be established. Say established. We shared with you. We almost through for the night. The word for decree is the word gezar, but the word for establish is a Hebrew word kum. Say kum. This word in Job 22 is the outcome of us speaking. See, we need to have our faith expecting something to happen. When we decree and declare a thing, we should expect something to happen. We should expect change. We should expect the atmosphere to shift. When we decree something to our children, we should expect them to be or do just what we said or decreed. When we decree something over our marriage, then we expect that change to be made manifest. The word kum is this word establish, in the idea that it is a transformative word. It means to arise. That wherever it was before, it was somewhere lower than where it should be. When it's established, it arises. When we decree a thing, it shall be established. It arises to notoriety. It arises into position. It arises, or it takes a stand. It is an establishment where we take a stand. When we establish something, we make a stand for what we decree. When a king makes a statement and he decrees it, then he takes a stand and he sends his army and his knights and his authority to back it up. Say cool. Say I'm establishing some things. I'm establishing things. Things gonna change around him. Things gonna change. I've been watching some things change, and I'm going to have to make a change. Going to have to make some change. That's what some of the husbands say to their wives. We're going to make some changes around here. And then I see the brother at men's group with a black eye. I know y'all aren't this. Okay. But it's cool. It means to establish something, that there should be a willingness to say, to not be afraid to make a declaration for good. And expect it to be established because we're participating in this change. You see, it took the centurion faith to come and say, Jesus, just speak the word. It took faith for Job to rise up and to go as God restored him. It took faith. It took that participation. Cool, this verb that means to arise. So not only do the circumstances change in our status, but we change. You know, every time you decree something and you see it, it does something in the spirit realm. What does it do? When you take the word of God for real, you decree a thing. God backs it up and it's established. First thing that happens, the devil begins to take notice. Hey, look what so-and-so did. He decreed a thing. They began to give note, fear, and you taking your rightful place. And when I say rightful place, it's to remind you and I that the devil is afraid of the glory that's a part of your and I's destiny. What is the glory? It's the manifested presence of God, which brings the power to bring change and brings glory or elevation to the name of Elohim, our God, Jehovah, our God. You see, Lucifer, AKA Satan,
worship God, that led the worship in heaven, that instruments are in him. All these instruments that we see were built inside of Lucifer. He could praise God all by himself. He didn't need, he didn't have to go through a musician problem. He was the musician of heaven. And he brought glory to God until he decided that he didn't want to praise God anymore. He wanted creation to praise him. He wanted the angels to praise him. He wanted the glory that belonged to God for himself. Beloved, it's important to always remember the glory belongs to God. All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you, oh God. Say, don't mess with the glory. Old Roberts used to tell us all the time in seminary, don't touch the gold, that means the money, of the glory. It belongs to God. Every healing that he is known to have been a part of, he would say, it's God. Every miracle, it's not me, it's God. When the law began to arrest him, saying that he was practicing medicine without a license, he could get out of it by saying, it's not me, I'm not the healer. God is the healer. All glory belongs to God. Say, all glory belongs to God. Whenever you find yourself in a place where people want to pat you on the back and elevate your name and say some wonderful things about you, I want you to look humbly and appreciative. I want you to gather yourself and look them in the eye and say, God gives the glory, not me. Say, God gives the glory. Shut that out of my seat. Know what you've done? You just added to your life. You just protected you from yourself from fall. You just went around on a major test. When we give the glory to God, we align ourselves with the mind and the king around. It is not us. It is God who gives the glory. Decree Gazar. Means to cut, we're cutting down the things that the kingdom of the devil is trying to establish. The lies that he placed in place that says you won't be healed. The lies that he's put saying that your family won't make it. When we begin to decree a thing, we're cutting down and cutting into every element that the enemy has intended. And when we cut it down, we establish, we cool it. It is to arise. We allow God to manifest in us. It will be established. It will arise. Our motive, our initiative, our what we decree will arise so that it will be in place. Say, decree. Declare and establish. Once you decree a thing, then you gotta establish it by faith. You gotta act like it's in place. When you do Joshua as for me in my house, we're gonna serve the Lord. You be the first one up on Sunday to go to church. Dressed and ready. Say, we're going to church in this house. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You gotta establish it by faith. You can decree and declare that my house will be called a house of God. But we got to pray. And we got to participate in prayer. When you decree a thing, it shall be established. But you have to move to establish. You have to use your faith. Just like the centurion established. He said that you don't have to come under all. You have to do say the word. The Bible said his servant was healed at very. My God, need you to decree some things and establish some things, to let some things rise up. Stand to your feet just for a minute, stretch out a little bit. And I just want you to close your eyes and just get one thing in your mind that you want to decree, that you want to ask God. Maybe a healing in your body. Maybe financial sovereignty. You want to decree something. I want you to decree something that unless God do it, it won't happen. I want you to decree a thing. Decree. Deliverance from drugs, deliverance from alcohol, deliverance from pornography, deliverance. Decree, marriage is healed. Decree, the new house. Decree a thing, and it shall be established. Decree, I want my family to come to church with and worship with me again like we used to. Decree a thing. And it shall be established. Now I just want you to begin to say it softly out of your lips. Just decree whatever it is. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you. We decree a thing. We decree, Lord God. We decree a thing. We decree a full house. People of God returning back to the house. We decree, Lord God. We decree, oh God. Every Sunday will be packed. We decree a thing. In the name of Jesus, we decree miracles, signs, and wonders. Lord God, that you would loose a season of miracles, signs, and wonders. We decree a thing that shall be established. We decree victory, right? Come on, decree financial liberty. That we'll be free from debt. Free from debt. That there'll be more money than there will be bills and expenditures. We decree, oh God, freedom from liability, freedom from legal entanglement. We decree some things. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for establishing it. We cut through the enemy's desire to keep us bound, to keep us enthralled in these earthly things, to keep us from focusing on kingdom things. We thank you, God. We decree our children will serve you. And another they will not serve. They will be removed from entanglement, from the spirit of religion, false religions, idols, worshiping titles, worshiping cars, worshiping watches, and worshiping things. We decree our children shall worship the Lord and Him only. We decree a thing that shall be established. Father, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you. We decree salvation, household salvation. There will be no one lost in our family line. No, our children, our grandchildren, our brothers, our sisters. They shall all know the Lord, serve the Lord. And it shall be established. It shall be established. You may have to go to them and witness to them. You may have to go pick them up. You may have to encourage them to help establish this decree. You might have to pray that God will send angels to fan the fires of worship and call them to the Lord. But we will decree it that it shall be established. You decree revival over this city. Oh, there's a spirit, oh God, of division. There's a spirit, oh God, of witchcraft. There's a spirit of manipulation. But we decree a thing that there shall be a revival. For hearts of men are turned to you. Let me begin in the pulpit. Pastors turn their hearts back over to you. Not to the board, not to the to the building that turn our hearts over to you. not to the title to you. Oh God, we decree it, and it shall be established. Revival, revival, revival. Hearts turn to you, Lord. We thank you. Father, we thank you for this time of refreshing, renewing reminder. And we give you the praise for it. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord another hand praise tonight. I'm going to let you sit. I'm going to take the benediction and reach you. I'm going to make you someone who wants to be saved tonight. You may be on Facebook, YouTube, you may be on the campus. But I decree the lost shall be saved. All you have to do is say this. Father, forgive me of all of my sins. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior. And I confess him as my Savior right now. I believe, as the word decreed, he died, and on the third day he rose. And I believe, as the word said, is coming back. Father, thank you that by my confession and by my declaration, I'm saved. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord another hand clap of praise. And you give your life to the Lord on YouTube or Facebook. Text us, GAMMC1 at AOL.com. Just let us know. Join us on the campus. Come up to us and let us know you gave your life to the Lord. Find a church so that you can worship and grow, teaching this Bible, the Word of God, that will change your life. We thank God tonight for you on this Tuesday, May the 11th, year of our Lord, 2022. So that when they see this video after the church's rapture, they'll know the when and the where, and they know where we've gone. We thank God for you. If nothing else, don't forget, church on Sunday, 11 o'clock. Yes, sister?
Sir, I'd like to say something to the
Lord, you're turning around for the good.
Thank you, Jesus.
And that all those that are involved will come out.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
With a heart for you.
Thank you. Yes, God.
Like never before. Thank you.
Yes.
Sister, thank you for that praise report. God bless you, beloved. We love you. Be blessed of the Lord and have a good night. If you want prayer,